Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Okay, so I'm going to be standing over there. So if you need to look at me, I'll bring you in. Okay? Yes. I don't want to stand up there.
Yeah.
I'll stand in the corner by those chairs.
Yeah.
Or I can even get closer to the stage.
Okay,
but
got
just
you.
Look at me, and I got you.
Is easy when you're up on the mountain.
peace of mind.
That's all right, please. All right.
Like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never alone.
Sisters, we're gathered here to celebrate and remember a mighty woman of God. Now, Esther might roll her eyes at me for saying that, but it's true. It is true. The evidence is right here. We celebrate Esther Sonya Byron, a dear wife, mother, sister, friend, who was a very influential person in each one of our lives. Today, we get to grieve together as a family, but we also get to celebrate together as a family. Church, as we start the service, let's start with a word of prayer, and I'd like to invite Bonnet Anderson Penley to have a word of prayer.
Okay, join with me in a word of prayer. Amen. Eternal and everlasting God, we praise you this morning. We give you the glory, we give you the honor. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, even in the midst, O God, of our grieving, O God, we exalt you, Father, because you are God, and indeed you are good. Lord, we thank you for the time that you have given us with Sister Esther, oh God. We thank you, Jesus, for the life that she has touched, oh God. Father, as we celebrate her life, oh God, and the death of a sister, of a wife, of a friend, Lord, we just thank you, oh God. Father, in the midst of everything, we say thank you, Jesus, because indeed you are a good God. And Lord, I pray, oh God, for the family this morning, oh God. Lord, in the midst of their grief, oh God, I pray that you will stretch forth your hands of comfort this morning around the family, oh God. Would you give them strength this morning, Father, in the name of Jesus? I pray that your joy, oh God, will surround them. For your word said that the joy of the Lord, it is our strength. So my God, in the name of Jesus, I declare your joy, oh God, upon the family this morning in the name of Jesus. Lord, as they grieve, they are not grieving as someone, oh God, who does not have a hope. But they are grieving, oh God, because they have a hope in you that one day they're going to see Sister Esther again. But Lord, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the days ahead, for the strength that they will need, oh God. Lord, I ask, oh God, that in the midnight hour, oh God, that you will reach out, oh God, your nail-scarred hand, and you so surround the family, oh God. Great and eternal Father, as a life, oh God, is celebrated to you, Lord God, I pray, Father God, that souls today will come to know you as Lord and Savior. We will not just celebrate the life, oh God, of a dear sister, a dear wife, a dear mother, friend that came back to meet you, Lord, but we will also celebrate, oh God, the life of many souls, Father, that is going to come to know you as Lord and Savior. For your word said, oh God, to be absent from the body is to be present with Christ. And Lord, we thank you this morning. We thank you, Father God, for the rest of the family, oh God, and the friends, for the community that is grieving this morning. Lord, I pray your comfort upon them this morning. Your peace which passeth all understanding, oh God, to guard their hearts and guard their minds. Lord, we surround them today, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, oh God, for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. And we thank you for the rest of the service. We commit the service to you, oh God. Let it be pleasing. Let it be accepted, oh God, in your presence, oh God, this morning in the name of Jesus. Father, above it all, we lift you up and we exalt you, oh God. Even in the midst of grief, we put grief, oh God, there, and we put you above the grief, oh God, because indeed, God, you are good. Indeed, you are awesome. We give you the praise, Father. We give you the glory, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's continue to stand as I invite the worship team to come up, and we're going to sing the song, How Great Thou Art. I know the Byron family loves to worship. And one thing I know about Esther, when I used to live in the basement, every once in a while you hear this voice. It wasn't Joel's, it wasn't Darian Durrell, it was Esther singing in the house. So let's sing this to worship our God and How Great Thou Art. Let's sing together.
Then sings my Mountain grandeur, and hear the brook
Whew. God is good. His presence is good. His presence is good. Amen. Amen. In this reverential presence, you may take your seats, please. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God. You feel him? You feel the presence of God? Amen. May he comfort you. May he bring you peace right now and strength. To Pastor Joel, Daria Durrell, the whole family, receive that presence. Receive that presence. At this time, I want to invite Denise and Deo to come up and give us a scripture reading. Scripture reading.
Ecclesiastics 3, 1 to 4. To everything, there is a season and a time, to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. Here is a portion of God's holy word. We honor by saying thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. Let's open our Bible to the book of Psalm 103 from verse 1 to 6. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The last verse. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. This is the word of God. May his name be praised.
At this time, I want to invite Rhonda to come and share a poem. Rhonda.
Well, I'm Rhonda, and this is my son, Matthew. We knew Esther like over 40 years, and she was the friend you could call on at any time of the day, of the night. We spent so many times laughing, even things that probably aren't funny to a lot of other people. We would sit and laugh and laugh, and these last few weeks have just been so hard because it's been half real and half not real, and there's many things that have happened since she's passed that I think, oh, just wait till Esther hears this story. She'll laugh. And then I realize she's not going to be here to laugh. So I just want to say to her, just thanks so much for all the time we spent together and what a blessing she was to me and my family. Whenever I needed help with my kids, she was always there for me, looking after them, whatever, in whatever way she could help, she was always there. So this poem is called If Tomorrow Starts Without Me, and it's a poem that she chose to be read at this service. So it says, if tomorrow starts without me and I'm not here to see, if the sun should rise, you find your eyes all filled with tears for me. I wish you so much you wouldn't cry the way you did today while thinking of the many things we didn't get to say. I know how much you love me, as much as I love you, and each time that you think of me, I know you'll miss me too. But when tomorrow starts without me, please try to understand that an angel came and called my name and took me by the hand. He said my place was ready in heaven far above, and that I'd have to leave behind all those I dearly love. But as I turned and walked away, a tear fell from my eye. For all my life, I'd always thought I didn't want to die. I had so much to live for, so much left yet to do. It seemed almost impossible that I was leaving you. I thought of all the yesterdays, the good ones and the bad. I thought of all the love we shared and all the fun we had. If I could relive yesterday, just even for a while, I'd say goodbye and kiss you and maybe see you smile. But then I fully realized that this could never be, for emptiness and memories would take the place of me. When I thought of worldly things I might miss come tomorrow, I thought of you, and when I did, my heart was filled with sorrow. When I walked through heaven's gates, I felt so much at home. God looked down and smiled at me from his great golden throne. He said, "This is eternity and all I've promised you. Today your life on earth has passed, but here life starts anew. I promise no tomorrow, but today will always last. And since each day is the same, there's no longing for the past. You've been so faithful, so trusting, and so true. Though there were times you did some things you knew you shouldn't do. You have been forgiven, and now at last you're free. So won't you come and take my hand and share my life with me? So when tomorrow starts without me, don't think we're far apart. For every time you think of me, I'm right here in your heart." Rest in peace, Esther.
At this time, I want to invite the Byron family tribute. They're going to sing us a song, "Can't Walk Without You Holding My Hand." Byron family, come on up.
Jesus said to come to the water and stand by my side and drink from the fountain. You won't be denied. He said, "I've seen the tears and the pain you've cried. And he sent me to tell you that for your tears, he died." Whoa, whoa, whoa.
not. Weep not. Weep not. She is not dead. She is resting in the bosom of Jesus. Heartbroken husband, weep no more. Grief-stricken sons, weep no more. She has only just gone on. Weep not, weep not, for she is not dead. She is just resting in the bosom of Jesus. Grief-stricken brothers, weep no more. Grief-stricken sisters, weep no more. She is not dead, but resting in the bosom of Jesus.
I thank God for me, Jesus, my all in all. From now on his name, I'm really gonna call. And if I can't trust him, I'll be no longer a human. But I can't even walk without you holding my hand. And one of these days I'm gonna say to the Lord, can't even walk without you, without you holding my hand. The mountain is too high, and sometimes the valley. Down on my knees, I learned to stand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk. The mountain is so high, and sometimes the valley gets so wide. Down on my knees, I'm there, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I say I can't even walk without you holding my hand, yeah. Oh, Lord, I need you to hold my hand, because she said, if I'm gonna walk, you have to hold me up, and so today I'm needing you. Thank you.
This time I want to invite Jenny Olson to share a personal prayer.
Good morning. This is a prayer I texted to Esther when I found out she was in the hospital and not doing well. I was thankful to have the chance to read it to her in person. It is also a testimony of Esther's love for Jesus and for people. Dear Jesus, thank you for Esther, and that we can fully trust her with you. We know you know her pain, you know her suffering, and you care about everything she is going through. You are right there with her. In her weakness, you make her stronger. We acknowledge all that you are. You are the God of love. You are the God of peace. You are our healer here on the earth and as it is in heaven. You are the God of joy, the deepest kind of joy, the joy that gets us through the darkest of nights and wakes us up in the morning. You are everything we need. We thank you for your son, Jesus. Jesus, hope of the world. Jesus, you abide in Esther, and she abides in you. And she's with you. Lord, my sister Esther has a significant role in the body of Christ. She has taught me through how she lives. She lives for Jesus. She lives to be wonderfully sassy, ha ha ha. So Jesus, our healer, we hope to keep Esther here healthy and miraculously stronger than ever. However, we praise you no matter what happens. We praise you in the middle of this storm, whatever may come. We continue to praise you, for you are with us yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I love you, Esther, my beautiful, sassy, strong, courageous, hilarious, sensible, wise, gracious, and kind friend. Her kindness speaks the truth in love. Your kindness helps those you invest time in to grow in wisdom and in truth. I have heard many say you are a great advisor, and I agree. Thank you for helping me and others grow in the ways of the Lord. I love how you love the people in your life. I'd like to close with when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus together, we will sing and shout for victory with Esther. And God is good. And all the time, God is good.
At this time, I want to invite Andrea Thorne to share a solo.
I was going to say something, but Jenny took that away because I don't think I could speak right now and sing, so I'll say what I need to say in song.
Remembering so well the day that I met you, you took me in your arms and caused dreams to come true. From the fear of what would be, you were always rescuing. When we're face the hills that I must climb. Some high and some low, but if you lead, I will go. And at the end, I'll see you were always there with me.
I'd like to invite Patricia Warner to come and give us a eulogy.
Good morning to each and every one of you. I am Patricia, Esther's youngest sister. About 3 days after Esther died, Dario contacted me with a message. And he said, "Mom says that you are to do the eulogy." He wanted my response. I hesitated. I sent back the message. If that's what mom wants, I will do it. Today I stand before you, flanked by my two brothers, Robert on my right, Jerry on my left. I don't think they'll have to do much more than stand. Esther Sonja Byron, Nee Warner, entered her earthly journey on September 28, 1955. A devastating Hurricane Janet had left Barbados in shambles only 6 days before. Any female born at that time was named Janet. Not so for my sister. My late parents, Carlton and Errol Warner, said she was like the biblical Queen Esther, who had endured hard experiences, and she would be named Esther. She did not disappoint. She was a queen by nature and character. Esther was a family person. She migrated to Canada at age 19. But never left Barbados behind. She overcame every obstacle. She was an excellent nurse, a devoted wife and mother, a caring sister, sister-in-law, aunt, and more recently, a devoted great-aunt. A true family person with a special bond to many, especially our Aunt Elsa, who could not be here, but who is online listening. She was also a trustworthy friend. You have said it yourself. Esther's love for family was unsurpassed. A telephone call to even mention that someone in our immediate family was sick led to the following. Calls throughout the day. Instructions on how to handle the situation. And if she deemed it critical, a book flight to Barbados. And on two occasions to Jamaica and then to the USA. In all cases, Esther was nurse in charge. As a child, Esther was fun-loving, spirited, and there may have to be a poll which would determine between herself and Brother Robert on my right, who had more friends. Esther loved athletics and was the fastest girl in her secondary, we call it in Barbados, you say high school here. As a result, she was chosen to attend the athletic finals at the Barbados National Stadium. We waited patiently to hear the results. Behold, Esther reached home all bandaged up. "What happened, Esther?" we exclaimed on seeing her. In true Esther style, she responded, "I fell, I have several cuts, but I got up and finished the race." That was Esther. Determined, strong, focused, a fighter, never owning defeat. We will plod on as a family. Also with me here are my two sisters, Rosalind and Janice. We will plod on. Esther had the same courage that each family member here possesses. There are gaps to be filled. Esther telephoned Sister Janice every day to check in on her. That's a hint to all the other siblings, including myself. She knew about everyone in the family when you would ask her if she had been told. For me, the bond was strengthened as she came not once, but twice to Barbados last year to take care of me as I went through a period of illness. During her illness, Esther never complained, but displayed admirable resistance until the end of life. Resilience. We, the siblings, end our appreciation with nuggets of gold. Rosalind, Esther was patient in every circumstance of life. We waited as she laid on her hospital bed until I reached Canada. She desired that last connection with family. Robert, her last comment to me on a situation I was dealing with was, "Robert, if others cannot do it, then you should do it." I took her counsel, and the outcome was positive. For Janice and myself, if we told her an unpleasant comment or situation, she quickly forgot anything Canadian. And in her Barbadian accent, she would respond, "What are you bothering about? Don't let people confuse you, yeah." For Jerry, who's on my left, he learned from Esther how to handle and manage troubling situations, and I'm learning how to be graceful in the process. Her niece Zara, the only niece in the family, so she's Queen Zara now. The nephews Shay and Stefan, who are here. Her sister-in-law Karen, who's also here with us. And her devoted great-nephew, Cairo, who's probably listening even though he's only 16 months in Barbados, want to all join in expressing heartfelt thanks and appreciation for your love and and care for Esther over the years when we could not be here, but more importantly, as she experienced her illness. We won't forget those present here of our cousins, Stephen and Leslie, and Malachi, Vicky, and those of the Warner Walters family who are joining us online. Sis, you left us beautiful memories. Before your departure from this earthly scene, we, the five, were on a cruise. And after Jerry heard, I don't know where he got his poetry license from, but he wrote the following, which I will share. And Esther actually heard it before she departed this life. Esther, a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. A shelter of encouragement, a rest stop for refreshing, an example of strength, a sister in word and deed, truly a sister indeed. Steady hands, helpful words, guiding steps, a good tree. Brave and unflinching, holding the shield of honesty, thinking of others ahead of self, nourishing and nursing, good leaves. Made from mummy and daddy, the matriarch and patriarch, good roots. True to your genes and upbringing, nurturing the best in your own, Dario and Darrell, good fruits. The love and care of a husband, his delight in you is clear. His ever supported and encouraging presence, a trunk you could climb on, a resting place, a shelter, a good trunk. United brothers and sisters, intertwined a family love, sharing in all experiences, good branches. The depth of the soil of soundness, the water of love, the winds of gentleness and peace, the grass of grace, good soil. My sister, our sister, good soil, good trunk, good roots, good branches, good leaves will always give good fruit. A good tree, Esther, cannot produce bad fruits. You were a good tree. You will be greatly missed. You will forever be in our hearts.
This time, I'd like to invite Angela O'Dain to have a few words to the Byron family.
On behalf of our sisters, Tessa, Joy, Betty, Utilda, Sally, our brothers Francis, Solomon, Jeffrey, and George. We extend our deepest condolences to Esther's family, and we thank all of you for coming to share today in this moment. This is not an easy occasion for me, so please bear with me. Patricia just eulogized Esther, and I want to celebrate her. For all you young persons out there, and those people who think they're in love, the real meaning of love is when someone loves you, they put your needs above theirs. As simple as that. Nothing complicated. Yeah. And Esther displayed that by the love that she showed to Joanne. And the principle of receiving is to give. So because Esther gave to Joelle, and she gave to all of us, Joelle gave to her, and we are here today to celebrate her. So this is just how we as a family felt about Esther, and I thought it was appropriate that we shared it today. Our dearest Esther, it's really hard to say goodbye. Instead, we will simply say, until we meet again. There are so many things we wanted to say. However, at this time, we chose to say the most important. Thank you. Thank you for your love and support of our brother. Thank you for raising two of our favorite nieces, and for the love, values, and strength of character you instilled in them. Your departure has left a void in the hearts of many. Your boys, as you so affectionately referred to them, are now left without their mom. Your husband, without his go-to girl, his compass. The many young lives you have impacted here at Shiloh Baptist and within our families will miss your wise counsel, your guidance, your listening ear, your love and support. For all that you were to them and so many others, we say thank you. To us, our sister Esther embodied the Proverbs 31 woman. She was selfless, devoted, kind, loyal, and faithful. And if you will just permit me a few seconds more, I'll read you just a few select verses from Proverbs 31 that I thought really embodied who Esther was. I read verse 10, 11, 12, 25 to 29. A wife of noble character who can find. She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. So long, sis. We will see you at the resurrection. Thank you.
At this time, I want to invite Shelley Harris and Chanel Martin to come and give personal tributes.
Good morning, ladies, gentlemen, friends, and family. My name is Chanel, and I would like to share a few minutes on who Auntie Esther was to me. From as long as I can remember, Auntie Fester, as I called her, was always part of my life. She started out as my mom's friend and then became a friend to our whole family. Auntie Esther was like a second mother to me. Anytime I couldn't find mom for a question or guidance, Auntie Fester's response was always aligned with what mom would say. She was a straight shooter, no fluff. She said what she thought, whether you liked it or not, but it was always spot on. She taught me a lot over the years. She was a woman of wisdom, strength, compassion, and love. She always said to keep friends of every age and stage of life. that everyone had something to teach and something to learn. She lived for the present, as she stated, we only have today. She taught me to be authentic and genuine, that others may not always like what you have to say, but to speak truth with love. She helped me grow as a woman of God and to love no matter how difficult it may be. Proverbs 31:26 says, when she speaks, her words are wise, and she gives instructions with kindness. This was my Auntie Esther. Auntie Esther and I had a mother-daughter, adult-child, friend-friend relationship, all rolled into one. I will miss our daily chats, random texts throughout the day, inside jokes and senseless chuckles. I will miss her stubborn demeanor, her far-fetched conspiracy theories, and her smile. I will miss my friend, my dearest Auntie Fester. I love you deeply, and I will miss you greatly. May your light and love forever remain as timeless treasures in our hearts. May you rest in peace and rise in glory. Love you always. From Chanel.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shelley. When Esther told me I was speaking at her celebration of life, I was honored but scared. I am a soft person and known to be the ugly crier in the room. So please, I'm grateful that you're all so welcoming. She said, don't worry, you won't be alone, you'll be with Chanel. She also said that some of you might be wondering, what is the white girl doing up there? I rewrote my whole speech about 36 hours ago from a 3 o'clock in the morning aha moment, so here I go. 10 things I love about you. I love that when we met in 1994 at the Royal Elk Hospital and I was an RN new to psychiatry, you quickly took me under your wing to teach me about psych nursing. We soon became friends. I love that you had the skill of diagnosing and figuring out people that was always on point. I love that even when life got busy for us, you reached out to see how I was doing, and it was like no time had passed, and our friendship has been for 29 years. I love that when we had landlines, now you young people won't know this, but she used to put me on hold several times because she had to take incoming calls because she was everyone's Esther. And when the call came in and showed Barbados, I knew that was time to let her go and we would talk later. I love that you could be a little late and I was excessively early, but we accepted each other and as is, with no judgments. I love that eating out with you was an adventure and how you directed the waiter to prepare your meal and drink in such detail to your liking. I love that we shared the same strong faith in God and in raising our children with strong values and shared pride as they grew up to be good people. I love that you were a beauty from Barbados and I grew up in a little Alberta town of 300 and you opened up my world by introducing me to yours. I love the Caribbean dances, the concerts, the parades, Shiloh's concerts and coming to Shiloh's, and the Jamaican patties you shared with me. I don't know where to buy them, so I might need that help after. I love that I could tell you a problem and you honestly told me honestly when I was the problem, and somehow it never hurt my feelings but made me a better person. I have one story of many to share. When Esther met my father, he was born in 1922 and a World War II vet, an Alberta farmer. I apologized to her ahead of time because I felt he could say something inappropriate. She told me not to worry. He didn't let me down. My face turned red, and he said, "I have never kissed a black girl." Esther, with her inner beauty and grace, bent down and gave him a kiss on the cheek, and we all laughed. Our loss is great, but my husband told me, when I am struggling, I need to think. WWMED. What would my Esther do? She would say, "Be kind to yourself. Be kind to others. And grieve as you need to. And know that I am with God." My dearest friend, I celebrate your strength, your devotion in God, and I will forever be grateful. I will always love you.
I just want everyone to take just a second for a deep breath. Everyone take a deep breath. Let it out. That's the breath of God right there. I just want to invite right now, it's going to be a tribute from the family, Davin, Dario, Durrell, and Pastor Joe Byron. Come on up, guys. Let me give them a hand, please. Mic on?
Hello, hello. All right. Good morning, everybody. My name is Davin. For those of you guys that don't know me, I'm Joel's second oldest son. I viewed Esther as a mother. She had a huge impact on my life. When I first came here to Edmonton, I was a little bit wild. I didn't really have much direction. And just being in the home, seeing my father, seeing Esther, how they manage the household, for me, it was very eye-opening. It was something I guess I didn't know that I needed. Just watching how they operate, I was like, that's good. That's something I think I want in my life, even subconsciously, right? Just understanding that. And throughout the years, she gave me advice. At that time, I was with my girlfriend for a very long time. I wasn't considering marriage or anything like that, but she just started to sprinkle little seeds, gave me advice. Hey, how's my girl doing? That's how she referred to my girlfriend. I'm like, how's she your girl? You don't even know her, right? But they would have conversations behind my back, texting. Like, I didn't know. I didn't know this was going on, right? But it worked out for the best, right? She helped my wife, now my wife at this time, helped her do pregnancy, giving her pregnancy advice, what to do with the child. And it's made our relationship a lot better, made our relationship a lot stronger. And if I'm being honest with you guys, it's probably the hardest part for me, just knowing that she won't be here to be with my daughter. And just to pass down all that advice and that know-how. It's definitely one thing I do regret, that I wasn't around more consistently. For myself, for my wife, and again, just for my daughter, just to be around that type of environment, be around that type of woman, that strength, just to see her, and hopefully she would have the same impact on my daughter as she did me. But going through this process, through the tears and the heartache, and just trying to process everything and understand what's going on, I think the silver lining for me is just understanding that she's in a better place, 100%. I know that she's with God. She's happy, and I think she deserves that. She deserves to be happy. So that's kind of something that I tell myself just to, get through. understand that she is in a good place and she deserves that. Last thing I'll say to you guys, for you guys that have parents, grandparents, just please make sure you guys cherish them, love them, respect them. It's because we don't know when our time's gonna come. All right, life is short, so make sure you guys respect your elders and love them. All right.
Hello, everyone. I am the baby boy. Before I start, I want to say just thank you all to coming to visit my baby girl today. I just want to say quickly, I'm just going to give a quick thank you. But before that, I usually take this from my dad. I'm usually not a person to read off a script, but today I want every word to be heard. So. First, thank you to Dario and Dad's friends for your support, whether it was coming over, calling, bringing food, or traveling to be here, your love was felt. Thank you to my beautiful family on both sides. Your grace and presence was felt in abundance. They say it takes a village to raise a child, but it also takes a village to help that child mourn. I thank you. A special thank you to the Harris family and the Mayor's Reed family. I can't even put words together on how much you all have been there for us. You have truly given us more than we could ever ask for during this time. I cannot be more proud to call you guys my family. Thank you to my friends, to Fran, for being there for me. And driving my mother to chemo, for Iman to being there for me and driving my mom to chemo as well, to Heba for helping us with the legal documentation and being there. To Nico for a list of things that you've done for me that there's too much for me to even mention. To John, to Ruth, to Duncan, to Royce, to David, to Matthew, to Sarah, Jesse, Allie, Belinda, Derek, Andy. There's so many people. I know I'm missing a lot. I'm sorry. But your ability to continuously check up on me has not been unnoticed. As I said, I cannot repay you for what you've done, but I promise you I won't forget. And thank you to you, Kels, for standing by my side through it all, for being at the hospital almost every day, for calling every day. You've shown me nothing but support in my darkest time. My mother always said it was strong to cry, but weak to give up. So today, guys, cry all you want. I know I will. But when you leave today, leave on 2 feet strong and ready to chase whatever dream you have. If not for yourself, do it for my mom. Okay, baby girl, time to dance, right? I say that because on February 24th, it was me, my dad, my mom, and Dario on FaceTime. The doctor told us the worst news I've ever heard in my life, which was that my mother had a week or two to live. I cried more than I ever have in my adult life, but upon getting myself together, I told my mom, well, I guess this is our last dance. She smiled and said, I guess it is. I lost my mother at the tender age of 26 years old. I can complain and sulk about it for the rest of my life, but I recall being told by several people that we had one of the most beautiful and impressively well-kept together families. So I will tell you now, those 26 years hold infinitely more weight than my 50 plus years I'll have without her. So let me tell you about those 26 years. Me and my mom's bond started very young. She took me to school every morning and until I was in high school. She went to every parent-teacher meeting, and she helped me study. We spent countless Saturdays on lunch dates at Albert's and clothes and suit shopping. She was the person I came to when I was scared, when I needed life advice, or needed to cry. About 3 years ago, when I moved to Fort Saskatchewan for my practicum, we became best friends. I learned about her past life, and she learned about my current one. We became closer and closer, and I had that moment when you stop looking at your mother as just a mom, but a person. A person who filled my entire soul. My mother was an inspiration to many, but most importantly to her baby. When my mom was diagnosed with breast cancer when I was 3, she used to go to chemo treatment, feeling weak and sick and disgusting, but take Dario to school with me on her back. It's those moments that will inspire me the most. She inspired me to be a roommate, a friend, an employee, a brother, and a son. She taught me how to love someone, how to cherish someone, and how to want more for myself. Mom, I promise you many things, and I will keep my word for everyone. You better guarantee it. I promise you I would take care of Dario and Dad, and you have my word. You're my number one supporter, the only person I know who talked trash to my face but was nice behind my back. I remember you never wanted to watch me and Dario sports games because you were afraid we would get hurt, so it was only chess and piano for you, the safe ones. I'll miss those moments. I'll miss going upstairs and having me and Dario lay on your bed with Dad and talk for hours. I'll miss you yelling at me to do some random task. I'll miss you inspecting my room, my fingers, my teeth, and telling me if I don't fix up, I'll never get married. I'll miss that smile on your face when you know I won an argument. I'll miss you waiting up until I get home from a late night out. I'll miss everything about you. You gifted me with a sense of drive and persistence, one that I'll never forget. The last thing that my mother did when she was about to pass was shed a tear while we were saying our final goodbyes, something I will always remember. Whether it's tears of joy, tears of sadness, or of pain, I'll remind myself of your tears to know you're still here with me. Regardless of your pain, you never gave up or gave less effort. You always put maximum effort in to show you loved your boys. I can only admire that from a distance now. You believed in me no matter how insane my ambitions were, and always let me know how proud you were of me. I know you'll continue to do that. I need you every day. I motivate myself in the day to make you proud and come home to your empty spot wishing I could sit and tell you. I'll miss you endlessly. If there's one last thing I want to say, I messed up by saying that it was me and my mom's last dance. I've come to realize it was just the end of our first one, our second dance. Our second dance started March 5th and plays out when we dance the night away in my dreams. Our third will be the most sweet when I meet you up there again. I found peace in your physical, but I'll find even more refuge in your spirit from now on. Keep leaning for me, Mom. I love you more than I thought I could ever love. You're my rain and my sunshine. I will celebrate you till the day I die. I love you, baby girl, your baby boy, Daryl.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for being here. Before I get into my letter from my mom, I want to take a second here to thank all my friends and family that have come to visit us, sent us flowers, brought us food, helped set up for the funeral service, or supported us in any way. I'd like to thank anyone that's driven from out of town, flown in from out of province or out of country, and everyone tuning into the funeral from home. Thank you for being here for my family. To my friends out east in Toronto and Montreal, thank you. Even though you're not physically here, the love is felt. I'd also like to thank Brian for honoring my mom's wish and helping me with the slideshow. To RC and Eman for driving my mom to the test. For driving to test when I wasn't able to be here. To Marvin and Sam for flying in to be with my family at the hospital. I want to thank Alex, Michael, Sean, and your families for all the love and support. And last but not least, to Shelly, Chanel, Auntie Rhonda, Auntie Deanne, Makara, Ray, and Matt. There are so many days we don't get through without you guys. So thank you. Now for the letter. Hey, Mom. Every day without you has been really hard. There's days when I don't want to eat, but I eat. There's days when I don't feel like doing anything or being around anybody, but I embrace the loved ones around me and do things to keep my mind busy. There are days when I cry myself to sleep, but I get up every day because you never taught me how to break. Instead of letting the pain consume me, I want to tell you about some of the many things I'll miss about you and the things I'll never stop celebrating. I'll miss hearing you boss us around the house and tell us where to move your furniture and how to do your landscaping. I'll miss you telling me that you want to do something, and by you, you mean me. I'll miss picking you up from work and taking you out to eat at our favorite restaurants. I'll definitely miss having you in my corner when Pops and Durrell don't want to eat at great food spots because the plates are too small. Yeah. I'll miss seeing you show up to support me in anything I try to accomplish. Even when you were going through chemo, you'd show up to my Meet the Teacher meetings when I was in elementary school, because what I was doing in school was just as important as what I was doing outside of it. I'll miss coming upstairs to check and see when you need something when you're not feeling well, and making sure you always got treated to takeout on Fridays once I finished work. I'll miss sharing my travel stories with you and telling you about the places in the world that you never got to see. You were more adventurous than a lot of people knew, and I'll miss exchanging those stories with you about your travels at my age. I'll miss taking you out on dates to live shows, like the Lion King musical, or taking you out or talking about music that you listen to at my age. I'll miss going to the store and buying you expensive perfume for your birthday just so you could walk me back to the store to make sure I returned it. I'll miss you telling me each time that I didn't need to buy you expensive stuff because the only gift you needed from your kids that mattered was that we were all together. Through it all, it's memories like these that enable me to smile through this hardship just like you did every day. Though I'll miss you dearly, you also left me with so much to champion about having you as a mom. I'll always celebrate how you showed us what a loving home looks like and what unconditional love is. You showed us what it meant for your home to always be a safe space for your children to be nurtured and to grow. You taught us that laughter is the best remedy for sadness. You taught us that home isn't based on where you live, but how you live together. You taught us what it meant to be a family. I'll always celebrate how much love you showed people. When it was someone's birthday, you never forgot to reach out to them and make them feel special. When family was sick, nothing could stop you from going to be with them. When someone needed help, you'd reach into your own pocket to help them, but what was more honorable was how you gave people your time. You listened and you never judged people for their mistakes. You showed us that you can voice your opinion without casting judgment on others. I'll always celebrate how you taught us to lead and not to follow, to choose our friends and not let our friends choose us. It's something that sounds very simple, but it has shaped how we look at our interactions with people, and it's the exact reason we have the love and support that we have today. I'll always celebrate the fact that you believed in us, whether it was in our studies, with sports, or anything we put our minds to, you never doubted that we could excel at anything. When I told you I wanted to move to Toronto, you didn't make leaving harder for me or ask me to stay. He just told me to never lose sight of my goals because you knew I could achieve them. You're the reason I believe in myself, and that won't ever change. I'll always celebrate you being the strongest person I know, no matter how much pain you were in, no matter how tired you were, no matter how many things went left in your life, you never complained. You just continued to find a way to move forward because you had to. That's why we face everything head on. We won't bend or fold without you because every time life broke you, you got up and put yourself back together again, stronger than before. I'll always celebrate how you kept your promises. You promised you wouldn't leave me on my 30th birthday, and you didn't. You somehow found the strength to hold on for one more day. The only reason turning 30 matters is because you were still here to have one last birthday dinner with me. I'll never forget that for as long as I live. For that, my last promises to you are promises that I'll keep making you proud. I promise that I'll take care of Pops, Durrell, and Davin, and that I'll make sure Araya always knows how much Miss Nona loved her. I promise to keep pursuing my goals, and I promise to continue to spread the love that you showed me to others because I'm my mother's son. I promise to do these things until we meet again with all the love that I have in me, your big son, Derry.
if you're expecting me to follow that, I ain't nothing. But I want to say thanks. What I see here today is a testament to the fact of the life that Esther lived. She reached to us in every corner that we found ourselves in. She reached out to us unhinderingly. Didn't matter who it was, what you say, what you look like. Her goal was to make you feel better. So let me say a few words of thank you first. Thank you all for coming out. I feel your love because you feel our pain. And so we are thankful for that. As my boy said, I want to also just extend that thanks for all those who came in from out of town. Those who came in from Jamaica, Karen and Zara. Those who came in from the States, my brother Solomon, Omer, Stephen, Rhonda, Nayuka. Those who came up from Calgary, my brothers and all the posses. And those of you who came from right here, thank you. I also would like to extend my thanks to the nurses and the doctors, the health care aides, thank you. See, sometimes, and maybe I got to see the professional side of those who take care of others when they're ill. But I also got to see the human side of it also. Esther was regarded as one of the best patients they had. She broke the heart of the doctors and the nurses and everyone who looked after her. Down the hallway, they were talking about the life that she lived, seeing that there were so many people who came out to visit and to see Esther. I want to thank all of you. I want to thank my church family. You have embodied what Jesus speaks about. The love that you show to us goes beyond here today. Jesus puts it this way. He said, when you love one another like you have shown and demonstrated to us, he said, the whole world will know that you are my disciples. To the Mayors, Diana, Rhonda, Shelley, Marcus, Rihanna, McCary, Matthew. I want to thank you all. And, Amy, Shelley, I want to thank all of you. You've been there for Esther when she was well, when she wasn't well. And now you're here with us. Now she's unable to speak. Thank you. Thank you. To my family, the side of the Byrons, and to my in-laws, the side of the Warner, we today feel surrounded by your love and your strength, your compassion. We today rest with that assurance, knowing that you are with us, that we could make this journey together. Without you, we won't be able to do it. You have started it, and listening, it doesn't finish today. It goes all the way to the end. Thank you. To every one of you today who have come in contact with Esther, you have felt the warm embrace, I believe. Esther embodies these words from the great Mother Teresa that reads, it says, spread love everywhere you go. First of all, in your house. Let no one ever come to you without leaving better and happier. Be the living expression of God's kindness. Kindness in your face. Kindness in your eyes. Kindness in your smile. Kindness in your warm greetings. Be true to yourself and impact others. Esther never gave birth to a daughter. Unfortunately. But Esther was an amazing judge of character. She handpicked several women whom she believed would fit the very characteristics of her daughters. First, her two beloved, Rhea and Sheena. And then all her adopted daughters, Chanel, Rhonda, Sarah W., Sarah B., Dale, Odisha, Tennis, Dora, Jenny, Juliana, Glenda, Arlene, Sarah, Karen, Belisa, Trinity, Kelly, Heba, Iman. Asi, Francis, and our latest addition to the family, Kelsey. Esther had strict guidelines for you all, and she wants me to tell you all about that today. And these are her guidelines for all of you, her daughters. It's taken from Philippians chapter 4, verse 9, which states, "These things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the God of peace shall be with you." Esther touched you all. And it's now your duty now to not to keep these to yourself or these lessons or guidelines to yourself, but to share it with others. In other words, she's saying, just as you were touched, go and touch someone else. I'm going to ask you a question. Did I see all those who believe in destiny? I mean, I want to see a hand. Come on. Esther, that's one of the conversations we have. I'm going to ask them if they believe in destiny. Do you really believe in destiny? All right, Esther, you've got it. Our hands went up. They believe in destiny. I have a destiny story for you. Just bear with me, please. So I emigrated to Canada March 11th, 1989. The following day, Sunday, my sister Joy took me to Shiloh Baptist Church. Just like we do today, we'd ask, is there any visitors? And I indicated that I was one of the visitors. After the service concluded, my sister Joy introduced me to Esther. Let's fast forward. 2 weeks later, my other sister Sally took me to Shiloh. And this time, Esther came over to me and said, "If you ever want a ride to come to church, I am available." But she never gave me her number. Eight months later, I had a function to attend, and so I didn't want to take one of my niece with me. So I asked my sister, "Can you get Esther to give me her number, please?" My sister, "Oh, I don't have anything to do with that. I have nothing to do with that." So I got her number. I phoned her up about 11 o'clock the night. And I said to her, you know, I have a function to attend. I know it's late. Short notice. You don't have to say yes. And she responded, are you asking me or you're telling me? I said, no, I'm asking. So here we are today. After 34 years being here. 2 years later, Esther and I got married. 8 years into our marriage, she got struck with breast cancer. And I made a decision. I said to her, I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to be right here. And I went before the Lord and I said, God, here is the deal. You can't take my wife now. I said, I can go out. If she passes, I can go out and find another lady and get married to them. But my children can't find another mother. You got to keep her mother alive, their mother alive. And he did just that. A few years into that, she was struck with heart problem as a result of the chemo treatment. She taught me what it means to be when I'm down, to find strength. She helped me to understand, even though I may be lying flat on the floor, weak, to remember these very words from the Apostle Paul. He went before the Lord and he said, God, I am troubled with something. Something in the physical. Maybe something in the spiritual, but whatever it was, he says, I need help. And he said, I pray these three times for you to remove it. And the words that came to Apostle Paul from the Lord Jesus Christ were these. He said, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. So Esther taught me, write your name in, remove the name Paul and put Joel. And I put it and I said, Joel, God's grace is sufficient for you. Because God's grace will be made perfect when I am weak. I know I don't have much time, but Esther was the rock of my life. She was the soul of my family. Listen. She was a loving, a wonderful person, virtuous woman, devoted wife, a mother, wise, selfless, kind-hearted, and outspoken, strong, peacemaker, loyal. She was a bridge maker. And all of you who know her knew that she made bridges when there was no path. She created a pathway so that those who are hurting or in pain can easily walk over and find comfort and find love. Esther faced many challenges, but her faith in God and her optimistic approach to life allow Esther to face her storms with a smile. Is it that kind of resiliency Esther instilled in our boys? She said, cry, yes. Say, I'm sorry, yes. Say, I made a mistake, yes. But give up, never. Stay true to your faith and conviction and defend it. All of those attributes would guide these boys into choosing the correct partner in life. She was a rock, my rock. We spend time when I come home from work. I have to debrief. She wants to know, how was my day? Vice versa, I ask, how was us? I remember coming home and see. And I said, she asked me, how was your day? I said, miserable. Somebody got under my skin. And I just told him off. I use some choice words, not swear words, but I use some choice words to describe how I saw the person. And she turned to me and said, "Were those your best words of choice?" So I asked her, "Well, whose side are you on?" It wasn't about whose side I was on. But those very few words let me understand that Esther was saying, "You need to go and apologize to that person." That I did. And what a difference it made. I said to you, those last few months of Esther's life, some of it painful, some of it happy. I missed the time when us going out along with my boys, going for supper, sitting and talking and laughing. Every cell phone was off or in silence. We interact. I'll miss what it is to have Esther and I lying in the bed and my boys come and throw themselves across the bed and we will laugh and we will talk. I miss what it is. I want to tell you, for all those 32 years, every single day I say to Esther, "I love you." I mean every single day. I never left the house one day without saying to her, "I love her." Even when we were in disagreement with each other. I close by saying to you, she's my sunshine baby. It's what I called her, my sunshine baby. And today God has chosen to take her away. But he comforts our hearts with all the joy and the love that she embodied and expressed to us. And live. For all of us today, I say, if Esther have touched your life, go out and touch someone else. My sunshine baby, until we meet again, God bless you.
Some beautiful words by the family. Beautiful words. Yeah. At this time, I want to invite the worship team to come on and sing "The Power of Your Love." I think that was another favorite song of Esther. Esther would sit in the second row with Pastor Joel, right there, second row, and you can just see her worshiping the Lord. So I want to invite you all to stand with us. And let's sing this beautiful song, "Power of Your Love."
Be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see.
we want to thank you for the power of your love right now in this room. But as we wait on you, Lord, Lord, we will rise up on eagle's wings, God. That when we run, we will not grow weary. When we walk, we will not faint. Lord, I pray that this power will sustain this family, the Byron family, and all the extended family. This power, Lord, will help them rise up on eagle's wings. That this power, Lord, as your Spirit makes them move, Father, they will say, God, your grace is sufficient for us. Lord, we thank you for your presence and your power and for your love. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Amen. Can we give God a big hand, please? Come on. Let me take your seats. As we're nearing sort of the end of the service, I want to share God's word with you. But before that, I want to tell you, I was so honored when Esther asked me to do a funeral before she passed away. I said, why? I was so honored. And I remember one thing she said, and I was like, if the Queen said it, it's good enough. She said, I always loved Bob's preaching. And I was like, that's good enough. Doesn't matter what anyone said. The Queen said it and got her approval. But more than that, I remember when they allowed me to come and live in their basement. When I was single and still pastoring here and still figuring out my life as a single man. And there was always the Queen in her home. And I always heard this one thing from this family, laughter. They always had laughter in their house. And when I got married, I told my wife this. I said, honey, that's one thing I learned from this family is they always made sure that they laughed. And I can never mimic it, only you guys can. You know how your mom laughed. One of those laughters that will just ring throughout the house and throughout the church and wherever she is. And that's when you know, Esther got the joke, even if the rest of them didn't. I'm going to read some characteristics of Esther that I want to share by Pastor Joel, Dario, and Darrell. I asked in just one word, one sentence, whatever, how would you describe Esther Byron? She's a bridge builder. She built bridges between people and treated everyone equally. She's slow to judgment. That little story that Pastor Joel shared, I can attest to that. She always had another way of countering the situation. And that way was always love. As Pastor Joel always called her, my queen. And literally, she would walk into a room and it was like a queen walked in. I also noticed how an incredible support she was to Pastor Joel. They were a team, and it was evident to everyone. They made sure they walked as a team, they worked as a team, they talked as a team, and even in counseling, they always did it as a team. She's a discerner of character, both good and bad. You don't have to tell her much. She'll just look at you, and she'll know exactly what sort of character you are. She was a great listener. She had a very protective nature. That's the mom side, right? Can tell when someone is going through a hard time even without asking them. She can tell. She had great laughter. She was a very loyal person. She kept things confidential. You could tell her a secret, and she will make sure she does not gossip. She will not share it with anyone. She kept it confidential. Darius says that she was the strongest person he knew. Even when she went through a hard time, she always had a smile. Always. I remember when I saw her a few days before she passed, she had that Esther smile and said, hi, Bob. I was like, wow, the strength in her. She always believed in people, even if you didn't believe in yourself. Very tenacious, she will get things done. Now, these are not my words. It's from her sister, bossy. But very kind. Caring, and she was the nurse of the family. Gave herself 100% to people. She always believed in education. And with the sponsor child, with Compassion Canada, she always checked on those children, always. That's something I loved about Esther. Every once in a while, I'll get this text even. How are you doing? And I would hear from people, yeah, I got this text from Esther, just out of nowhere. You might not have seen her for days or even for years, and she'll still make sure that she said hi to you. Amazing. Durrell said, I have an abundance of characteristics that I love about my mother. First is selflessness. To be a mother is the epitome, I'm going to ruin that word, of being selfless. But she not only cared us and catered to our every need, she also gave every ounce of herself to ensure we succeeded. Another characteristic is honesty. I was the tallest, the funny, and the smart kid. His words, not mine. No one could be more brutally honest than my mother, which is true. It's true. She's the reason I have the ability to understand my weaknesses. She's the reason I can be strong and talk now, even after her passing. My last major characteristic for my mother is passion. My mother was my first love, my first friend, my first enemy. That's what you said. I watched my mother love my father, and together they showed me how to love all the people I do today. That was an incredible example, even I observed from them. My mother passionately worked her job and showed me how to work hard. My mother also passionately devoted her life to God and showed me how to do that too. I wouldn't be half the man I am without her. You know, as I was meditating on all these statements, I was like, it looked like Esther lived the gospel out. Isn't that true, church? Those words describe the very characteristics of Jesus. And she was Jesus to everyone in this room, every single one of you. I remember a quote that Pastor Joel always used to say from St. Francis of Assisi. Preach the gospel and when necessary, use words. So we like to talk a lot. We like to preach a lot. But living it out, that's a whole nother game, right? People watch you than your words. And something about Esther, she didn't talk much. I've noticed the times where I knew she could have said something and it would have just pove, like an arrow into the heart, but she kept quiet. But one thing about Esther, I realized she lived it out. And look at the evidence right here. That's the fruit. This is the fruit. You guys are carrying something that she lit up in your heart, right? She lived the life of Jesus. She was influential in the kingdom of God. I know Shiloh Baptist Church will miss her. Will dearly miss her. I know you need pastors, but more than that, you need pastors' wives. Without them, things will fall apart. And I'm telling you that right now. In the days and months to come, I want every godly man be a support to Pastor Joel. Be a support to him. Love on him and pray for him. You hear me? Thank you. Esther left an imprint in everyone's lives, past and present. This church was blessed to have an influential woman of God who supported her husband and her family to help him become an incredible pastor here. All right? Pastor Joel is an incredible man, and I saw how much Esther loved and supported him. To hear of Esther's passing was so hurtful in my heart. I said, God, I felt more for Pastor Joel and for the family, but I know you'll be well-loved and supported by your friends. Isaiah 41 verse 10 says this, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." This is God speaking. I will uphold you. I will support you. I'll be with you. You have nothing to fear. 365 plus 1 days, God says, "I am with you. Fear not." Isaiah 43:2-3 says, "When you pass through the waters," which right now you guys are passing through the waters, God says, "I will be with you." And when you walk through the rivers, which you guys are walking through the rivers, God is saying, "They shall not overflow you." Even if it feels like you're drowning, He will support you. God will support you, and He will hold you up. Just as He didn't allow Peter to sink when he walked out of that boat and said, "Okay, God, Jesus, I'm going to walk out of the boat," and he began sinking, Jesus came and supported him before he could drown. Church, He will not leave you alone. Do you hear me? He will not leave you alone. His promise is, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." There is no divide between you and God. Jesus brought that divide together, and now you have fellowship with God because of Jesus. He is with you. When you walk through the fire, you guys are walking through fire right now. You guys are walking through fire. It says, "You shall not be burned." Even when you feel the heat of the fire, you're not going to be burned. "Nor shall the flame scourge you." And why is that? Because the Bible says, "For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." I am your Lord and your Savior. So you will not be burnt out, scourged, or drowned. I am with you to lift you up. I am with you to lift you up. Psalms 139, 7-12 says this, "Where can I go from your spirit?" David is saying this. "Where can I flee from your presence?" It doesn't matter how much you try to escape from God, you cannot escape from Him. "If I ascend into heaven, you are there." See, we all imagine God to be in heaven. All of us, we think, "Oh, He's up in heaven. He's too far away." But look what He keeps saying. "But if I make my bed in hell," if I make my bed in hell, and sometimes it feels like we're going through hell, and God, and He says, "You are there." How can you imagine God to be in hell? How? Because He's the Lord of everything. Not just heaven above, not just the earth, but even hell itself. So if you're going through hell, Bible says, "God, I cannot escape from you because you are there. You are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the outermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, 'Surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me.'" In other words, the light looks like darkness to you. "Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you." Can you imagine that, guys? Both darkness and light look alike to God. If you're walking in darkness, He is there with you. I remember it was in you guys' basement where God met me. We always hear the message, "Oh, I met Jesus, I met Jesus, I met Jesus, I met Jesus." I want to tell you, God met me, and it was in your guys' basement. I was reading the Bible and reading it and reading it, and all I saw was an angry God, mad at me about everything I ever did. I finally shut that Bible down, not because the Bible was wrong, because my perspective was wrong. I saw God in the wrong light. I said, "Lord, I can't pick up the Bible. I'm struggling with you." So I picked up my PlayStation remote. I won't tell you what video game I played, because even by saying the pastor plays video game, it's like, what? Yeah, we do. Some of you drink wine. I play video games. I don't know. And I said, Lord, I'm picking up my PlayStation remote, and I am just going to play my games. I'm going to mind my own business, because right now I can't take you any longer. And right there, I don't know if you guys still have that couch, maybe not, I felt God come and sit right next to me. I said, what are you doing here? I'm not reading my Bible. I'm not praying. I'm not doing the holy things. I'm just playing my video game, minding my own business. What are you doing here? And this is what I heard from God. I'm interested in what you're doing. How are you? He met me. And that was only one of the darkest moments I've encountered. And light shined in my dark world right there. I had no idea that God was interested in my life. All this time I was like, God, I will serve you, serve you, serve you. And now you're God saying, let me help you. Let me serve you. Let me walk with you in your darkness. We all know that Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Well, the rest? He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow, it's a shadow. It's the shadow of death. I will fear no evil. Why? Because you are with me. Your rod and your staff. Let me read it from a different translation just to help, especially my Gen Z crowd. Even when your path takes me through the valley of deepest darkness, fear will never conquer me, for you already have. Jesus already has. Your authority is my strength and my peace. The comfort of your love takes away my fear. I'll never be lonely, for you are near. Wow. And at the end it says, so why would I fear the future? Only goodness and tender love will pursue me all the days of my life. And then afterward, my life is through, I will return to your glorious presence to be forever with you. Esther is in the glorious presence of her Savior. Ain't that amazing? I want to ask you today, how many of you want that hope in God? That hope in God. A simple yes in your heart to the Lord. That's all you're saying. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I want that hope. That I am going to dwell in your presence forever. Let's just take a second. I know we're over time. But I want to give you a chance. Everyone close your eyes for a second. And then the slideshow will begin. Everyone close your eyes just for a second. I want to ask you something. What is your answer to God when he's asking, will you come? Will you come? I am with you through the hell and back. I'm with you through darkness and light. I'm with you when you're walking through the river, when you're passing through the waters. I'm with you when you feel like there's fire all around you. I am with you. If your answer is yes, I pray in Jesus' name right now that you will experience the love of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, whom Esther preached in her life. Let peace like a river right now flood your soul. Thank you, Father. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. At this time, the family has prepared a beautiful slideshow. So just take a few minutes and let's enjoy. As we close, I'd like to say a word of prayer. Could we all stand, please? In a posture of receiving, you're welcome to put your hand out to receive from the Father as we pray for the family. Dear Father, we thank you for your presence that is ever with us and will never leave us. We thank you for your presence even now as we come to the close of this service. I pray that as your children depart, they would know how loving, caring, abiding is your presence with them. Lord, we lift up Pastor Joel, Dario, and Durrell, and Davin, and the whole family. We pray for peace upon them, the comfort of the Holy Spirit, and the sweet memories of their loving wife and mother to abide and to be cherished all the days of their life. I pray that those that have been touched by her life and knew that she truly loved Jesus would be able to learn to trust you again, that you are a good God and a good Father, that they would learn to follow you as Esther did all the days of her life. Thank you for this time of celebration and remembrance of our dear sister and friend, Esther Sonia Byron. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. At this time, I want to invite Janelle to just come up and give us instructions. You're all invited to come to the burial site, and we'll have another celebration there as well. And following that, we'll come right back here for refreshments. Janelle.
Good afternoon, everybody. As we leave to go to the cemetery, there's some very important rules you all need to follow. First of all, if you haven't had a chance to sign the guest book, please make sure you do that either on your way out or when you come back for the reception. I encourage you to carpool to go to the cemetery. There are a lot of us, and the more cars, the longer it's going to take us to get there. So please do carpool, get in where you can. Second of all, this sign. This goes in your front window, along with your four-way flashers and your high beams, all right? All of those things, make sure you stay close. Don't let anybody in between you. You are allowed to go through red lights. You are allowed to go through stop signs. If you get a ticket and you have met all of the requirements, your sign, your four-way flashers, and your high beams, send your ticket to Trinity Funeral Home and we'll make it go away. If not, the ticket is yours. So when you go, please go swiftly. Please stay close. Do not let anybody in between you. Any questions? All right, go safely, everyone. God bless.
Please take your seats. You can take your seats.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, and I am worn. Through the storm, through the night. Hear my cry.
The day.